you're talking about now. Now all I can see is chaos and confusion and panic.
Hyvää iltapäivää, Gueftamiddag. Good afternoon. Thanks for inviting me here, all you hackers. My name is Martin Mikkos. I'm the CEO of HackerOne. You are the hackers. I represent HackerOne, which is sort of the Robin Hood of the hacking world. We take money from the rich and we give it to the smart. We're a bug bounty platform, the world's leading bug bounty platform. We've paid over $13 million in bounties to people like you, to hackers who have found vulnerabilities in systems of our customers, over 700 programs running. And those $13 million is wonderful money for you, but it is nothing compared to the improvement of security of systems. And the mission of HackerOne is to empower the world to build a safer internet. And that mission, unfortunately, won't end anytime soon. We have an internet and a connected world that's so sorely broken and open and vulnerable and buggy that it's not even funny. But it is very funny with lots of hackers who will find the vulnerabilities and then engineers who will fix them, and then ultimately systems will get stronger and stronger and stronger. But as we know in the business world, if you represent a company that has an attack surface and is vulnerable to attacks, you don't have to be fully secure. You just have to be more secure than your competitor. Because the sad reality is that criminals and nation states, hacktivists, whoever is hacking you criminally, will go for the lowest hanging fruit and the easiest targets. So those of you who represent the company, you just have to be better than everybody else. And then you already avoid most of the hacking and avert most of the threats. So I'll be talking about not that much hacking today, mostly just money and how this whole thing works, because somebody needs to make sure that hackers get paid for what they do. We have amazing talent in the world, people who have learned how to hack, how to break in, people who can think bad and still do good, meaning they can think all the bad ways of getting into a system, but once they are in, they stop there and they report it responsibly to the owner of the system so it can be fixed. And then in return, they may get a bounty payment from the company as a reward of this. And we have some wonderful extreme examples of bounties. There was a Finnish boy last year who made $10,000 on Instagram. He's 10 years old, and he found a way to erase anybody's comments on Instagram, and they paid him $10,000. We have the biggest promised maximum bounty in the world coming out of Finland. Local Tapiola, the insurance company, has offered $50,000 for the most severe bugs. That's a maximum on our platform. So we have just fantastic examples. And we have many Finnish hackers who have made bounties of 5,000 or 10,000, and of course many more, much less. Teemu K is one, and Jouko is another one, and there are a few other, you may be here in the audience. Amazing hackers who are finding vulnerabilities in systems. And fortunately today, there are responsible companies who will invite you to hack them and who will not prosecute you, will not threaten you with legal action. As long as you follow the rules, they will thank you for the report and they'll pay you a bounty for a good, valid report. Let's see. There we go. Last year, over 100 billion lines of code were shipped into production around the world. And this is an estimate. It's probably even more. But 100 billion lines of code is a lot. And many of you have theories of how many bugs you have per 1,000 lines of code. And bugs are not the same as vulnerabilities, as you know. Many bugs never lead to vulnerabilities. Many vulnerabilities don't even need a bug to exist. But it's clear that if you put 100 billion lines of code into production, you will, by definition, have a lot of vulnerabilities that you didn't think of, you weren't aware of. And companies keep pushing code more and more frequently, so there are just more and more vulnerabilities that somebody needs to fix. And we haven't figured out a single automated system or software that can find the vulnerabilities on their own. I don't know if it is good news and bad news. I think it is sort of good news that human beings can't help but produce crappy code, and the only ones who can figure it out are human beings. So somehow we are needed on this planet. First, we are needed to create all the incomplete and insufficient systems, but then we are also needed to figure out what was wrong. The key is, of course, that the one who produced it can never find a flaw in his or her own system. We have an ownership bias as human beings. Everything we produce is the most beautiful in the world, and we cannot find a flaw in it. Whether it's a code or a baby or whatever food we make, we can't find our own flaws. But somebody else can. And that's the idea of bug bounty programs, that you ask those who have no ownership stake, who don't know how it was built, who have no inside information, and that lack of connection to you, lack of information, is what makes external white hat hackers so enormously more productive than in-house people. When you ship code in a company, ask your colleague, could you take a look at my code? They will never find the vulnerabilities. If you ask the whole world to look at it, they'll ultimately find all of them. So it's a big, big thing. And for a company, there was just yesterday a report published that the average cost of a data breach of a company in the whole world is $4 million. And if you're an American company, the average is actually $7 million. So again, those who run companies are sitting there with a risk of suddenly facing a cost of $4 million on average if somebody breaks into their system. And then they think, okay, if I can avoid the $4 million cost, maybe I should spend $10,000 or $100,000 or $1 million on a bug bounty program and find those flaws and fix them before criminal people find them. And by the way, at HackerOne, to us, hacker is a very positive word. If somebody does something criminally, they're criminals, they're not hackers. Hacker is a very positive word and very positive people. And we like to define it as one who enjoys the intellectual challenge of creatively overcoming limitations. Some hackers create code. Here in this context, hackers are those who break into code and find the flaws. And it's a very creative process, and they have to have a lot of curiosity. So that's why sometimes I say it's curiosity that kills the bug. Not the curiosity of the bug, but the curiosity of the hacker. Meaning there's unlimited curiosity somewhere here. One of you will figure out a crazy way of getting into the system and figuring out how to break it, and then you'll stop there and file the report and get paid for it. So, why do you hack? We asked our hackers. HackerOne is running 700 programs today. We have nearly 100,000 hackers on our platform. And we asked our hackers, say, why do you do this? Because we have never promoted our service to hackers. They just come to us. So we asked them, why do you do this? Always the number one response is to make money. But always, it is just the number one by a small margin. So if you're cynical, you'll say, hackers just hack for the money. If you're not cynical, you say, money is part of it, but every hacker has one or two or three other motivations for doing it. So the money is a very welcome demonstration that what you did was useful, but it is not the only reason. Many hack to have fun. That's number two. It is so exciting to find a bug, to work hard and figure out and have the creativity and the fantasy to come up with things that nobody thought of that you can try out. That's why they do it. And talking about that, about how much fun it is, I also know that the least fun when you hack, security hack, is when you find a duplicate. In a bug bounty program, you get only the first one to report a certain vulnerability gets paid. If you're the second one to report it, the program will respond, sorry, this is a duplicate, and you get nothing. It's a tough moment because you knew you did the right thing. You found something useful, but unfortunately you were slow. Somebody else was faster. There are programs who will pay you small bonuses to keep you motivated and thank you for your good work. But this is the harsh reality of a bug bounty program. You have to be first of all those who are finding the bug. So you're in a rush to find it. This is, by the way, also a mechanism that over time will reduce and kill the black market for 0 days. If you find a really severe 0 day and for some reason you are criminally inclined and you are thinking of selling it to a nation state or a criminal organization and they'll pay you €1 million for it, there could at the same time be another hacker who says, heck, I'm not going to try to sell it to criminals. I'll report it immediately. I'll get a bounty of 10,000 and I'm good. And I don't have to take a risk. I don't have to weaponize it. I don't have to negotiate with shady people. And then they'll sell the same 0 day to the company who owns it and they'll fix it before it can be exploited by the criminals. So this notion of speed of action is actually healthy for the overall state of the connected world and reducing the market of criminally trading in 0 days, which still today is a fairly significant market. So number two was to have fun. Number three is to be challenged. Many hackers are far too intelligent for what society asks from them. So they go to school and they are bored. They go to university, they are bored. They talk to their family and they are bored. They talk to their friends and the friends don't understand them. They need some real challenge and they don't find it anywhere. But in a bug bounty program and when hacking, they actually get challenged to the level of their own ingenuity and intelligence. Then number four, to advance my career or build my resume. If you are a business person like me, you use LinkedIn as your resume. If you are a developer, you use your GitHub profile as your resume. If you are a security hacker, you use your HackerOne profile as your resume. You show there what you found on what companies, what they paid you. That shows your skills more than anything else. That allows you to gain entry to universities or land a job somewhere. And we are seeing it at HackerOne all the time, how there are many hackers who have nothing else to show than their HackerOne profile, and it's very impressive. And then finally, the fifth reason, to do good in the world. The press will write about all the criminal hacking stuff so much that some people will think that hackers are somehow bad or weird or criminal. It's just not true. Most of the hackers have the best of intent. They are the only ones who can build a safe, connected society for us. And they do it because they want the world to be a better place. They hack on open source projects for no payment because they know it's needed. They do a lot of things to help each other. It's a wonderful, wonderful group. And I've seen it now as being CEO of HackerOne for a year. I've spoken individually to over 150 hackers. And they have just the most sincere and pure intents with what they do. Yes, they are all very impatient. Yes, they all are strong-willed. Yes, they are all have their own personality. Yes, many of them don't communicate in the most elegant way. But just ignore that and look at what's driving them. And it's very high ideals and very good intent on what to do. So it's fantastic to see. So that's why you do it. I don't know if you recognize this, but this is what you told us when we asked. Then, how old are you? You're very young. The youngest hacker we've seen was 10 years old. We have many who are 12, 13. The founders of HackerOne, the two hackers who started it, they were 13 when they started hacking together in Holland 13 years ago. So you see, between 13 and 17, 6% of our hackers. Between 18 and 24, 43.5% of our hackers are in that age bracket. Most of these are male. We're trying to change it, but it's just a few percentage points of female hackers. So if there are female hackers here, please come and talk to me. We need to make you role models and show everybody else that this is a good job for not just young men, but also young women, and not just young, but also old. But you will see that it's very heavily skewed on the young people. The young people who have lots of time, lots of curiosity, are not burdened by too much knowledge, too much arrogance, too much success yet. They're just eager to do something and they figure out ways to break into any system. Like when HackerOne was invited to run Hack the Pentagon, where we hacked the US Department of Defense. You guys, not exactly you, but are the 1,400 hackers we had there, it took them 13 minutes to find the first vulnerability. 13 minutes. That's how fast we hack, and it's these people, many of them young. There is no hacker education in the world, it's pretty obvious, because when we ask where you learned it, you're just self-taught or your buddies told you. There's nothing else. 3% say they've taken some class or certification program, so that's practically nothing. So it's interesting that hacking, which is an absolute requirement for this world to become a better place, is still not taught properly anywhere. So all those people who actually can save our planet and make it safe and secure, they've just learned it on their own. So what the heck are all those universities doing? Like, they should be building a future society and people who can build a future society, and they're not even touching this topic. It's a weird dissonance there that they are training all kinds of, I don't know what, in the universities, but the ones who can truly make this world function, they are nearly all self-taught. 74% self-taught, 10% were taught by a friend. And I remember when I reached out to one hacker, Hisham Mir in Sialkot in Pakistan, 16-year-old guy, and I said, "Hey Hisham, how did you learn to hack?" And he was on Facebook. First he said, "Sorry, sir, I have to go to school now," because he went to school. Then he came back and said, "Google is the hacker's best friend." So he's just Googling things and learning that way. And then he said he would read every night when he went to bed. He would take his smartphone, go to hackerone.com and start to read our publicly disclosed vulnerability reports. And he did so for 7 months. And I guess that his parents had no idea, because he was probably there in the bed sort of hiding and reading something and learning to hack. So in 7 months, using the public reports and Google, he learned to hack and he started hacking. And then he earned $1,000 from Coinbase in San Francisco for a vulnerability. That's a lot of money for a 16-year-old in northern Pakistan. And now he has gone on to community college or college, and he's paying his tuition with the bounties he's making. And he has done this completely on his own. Nobody else has helped him, taught him. He just decided he will go start doing it himself. And that's what's so amazing here, especially for somebody like me. I've spent all my adult life essentially building infrastructure software, open source software such as MySQL, where I was the CEO, and then other parts. And I know that to build a proper online system, if you're building a mobile app or you're building a new Uber or whatever, you will go and hire a software architect who has at least 2 decades of experience, because you want the person who has seen all the difficulties and has a good sense of software architecture. So easily 2 decades or 15 years of experience. These hackers, they have 1 year or 2 years of experience, and they're breaking into all those systems that were built by those who have 2 decades of experience. So there's a huge difference here in how fast you can learn. When you have that intellectual thinking, the intelligence needed, and the curiosity and creativity, it's not enough to be intelligent. You have to be very creative and curious. Then you can rise to the top in just 2 to 3 years. It's amazing. Of course, not everybody rises to the top. And when we have 100,000 hackers, most of them are not rising to the top, but some few are becoming the Formula One drivers or the NHL hockey players or something. They're rising to the top and being world heroes, making lots of money. But it's, of course, only the best who will get there. Then we asked what you do as your day job. And there it's pretty varied. Nearly a third will say they're security practitioners, so they work in a security team for some company. Nearly as many are students who do it as a side job. Some are software developers, consultants, IT administrators, other unemployed, government, retired, and so on. So it's a pretty broad scale of what people do. And most of our hackers hack less than full time. They may hack 20 hours a week, which is less than full time. So they have a full-time job studying or working, and then they hack up to 20 hours a week. That's the most typical profile we have. To companies, when we promote this, we show this picture showing it's about strength in numbers. No matter what your company is, you always have a limited security team. Even when you go to your vendors and suppliers and ask them to help you, you have no more than a few thousand people who know security. When you go out to the broad community of white hat hackers, there are hundreds of thousands of them. Just on our platform alone, 100,000, but there are more. It will grow to a million, and it will ultimately be multiple million white hat hackers who do this for the reasons we mentioned and who are ready to help. So Uber, the CISO, said, if you don't run a bug bounty program, it amounts to negligence. Meaning, if you don't run a bug bounty program, you should be fired as a CISO. That's what he meant. Not everybody agrees with this yet. Many of you has probably sent in vulnerability reports to companies and you got no response and you said, why don't you run a vulnerability disclosure program or a bug bounty program, and you heard nothing back. And that is the true state of companies today. It's a little bit like going to a medical exam every year and getting all your results. Even though it's good for all human beings, many people don't do it. They don't want to know what's wrong with them. And it's the same with companies. Many companies still lack the courage to ask what's wrong with them. But that's the only way to become secure. So the hackers are just amazing, amazing people. Here are some examples. Up on the left there, we have Santiago in Buenos Aires. He tweeted a month or two ago, my new car, a Peugeot. Thanks a lot, Hacker One. This would not have been possible without you. And on the right-hand side, Shubham Gupta, a little bit earlier, said, finally going to buy a flat for my mom from Bug Bounty. So the money they are making on the bug bounty is changing their lives. They are paying school tuition, university tuition, they are traveling, they are taking their family to places, they are buying cars, some are buying apartments, and it's completely changing their life. At the low-tech, there's one guy in Germany, I don't know him, but I spoke to him over email, and he wrote, at the time that I found out about your project, my life was a mess. Thanks to HackerOne, I could get my life together, not just because of the money, but because it showed that my knowledge has value. That's very key here. Your knowledge has value. Because many times a hacker community goes to an event called Disobey, and it's sort of hidden away, and the society or businesses don't pay attention. But this is the knowledge that has true value for our society. And that's what makes it worthwhile, both for the hackers and for the companies. Up in the middle there, that's Franz Rosen, a Swedish hacker, one of the best on HackerOne's network. We made for him this picture to give it as a gift because he's so good. So when you get up there, when you start on HackerOne, you get 100 reputation score, and then it starts growing every time you send a good report. Some get up to 1,000 points. That's already an amazing accomplishment. Our best hackers are now over 10,000. We have 6 hackers who have reached 10,000 reputation points already. And if you start at 100, it may feel like you can never get to 12,000, but you can. Just keep doing it, and ultimately you'll be among them, and they'll grow tired, and you'll beat them, and you'll win on the leaderboard and become the winner. It's all doable. It's a very dynamic group, and many actually, although there's fierce competition between the hackers, they help each other and share best practices. So here are the stats I told you already. We have about 100,000 hackers signed up. Not all of them are successful yet, so it takes a lot of work to even file a vulnerability report. And when you file one, only 1 in 3 will have been paid for it. So it's not like it's an automatic machine where you get paid immediately. You have to be pretty smart and pretty good to get paid. But once you get paid, it can be amazing. our best paid hacker made over $500,000 in 2 years on HackerOne alone. And he hacks on many other programs as well. So over 500,000. And he happens to live in Las Vegas where you pay no taxes. So that was 500,000 in cash to him. We've paid over 13 million in bounties to 70 countries around the world. The average bounty is $477 last year, but it varies from all the way down to some pay $10, some pay up to $30,000 and $50,000. We've fixed over 35,000 vulnerabilities, or our customers have, thanks to the system. And of those, about 10% have been publicly disclosed so that everybody can read them and learn from them. There we have some of the examples of customers that have signed up with HackerOne. Yahoo, Adobe, LinkedIn, Dropbox, Twitter, Ubiquiti Networks, Riot Games, Slack, Airbnb, Square, Salesforce, Blizzard, Cert, Uber, Cloudflare, Gartner, General Motors, and so on. A lot of companies now coming on board, and more traditional companies, not just cloud companies, who are starting to run bug bounty programs or vulnerability coordination programs. I mentioned Hack the Pentagon. We were handpicked last year by the Pentagon to run a program for them. That was the first time ever that they invited others to hack them. We had 1,400 invited hackers. It was only US taxpayers, so many of you probably couldn't have participated. They found nearly 1,200 vulnerabilities, and of those, 138 were deemed valid and were fixed very quickly by the Pentagon. And the first one came in 13 minutes after the program was opened. All of this happened within 8 weeks. Before that, the Pentagon had spent over 3 years, $5 million on pen testing and found only a few tens of vulnerabilities. So this was by far their best security program ever. And Ash Carter, who still is the Secretary of Defense, participated in every press release to make it known to the world what they are doing. And today we are running an ongoing program for the Department of Defense. We just concluded Hack the Army, and we have a vulnerability disclosure program for the Pentagon where everybody can send in vulnerabilities. But that underlying program doesn't pay bounties. So if you are not US taxpayers, you can file reports there, but you won't get a bounty. The bounties are only to US taxpayers, unfortunately. But you can get on your profile page saying, I found a vulnerability in the Pentagon, which is a pretty cool thing. Here's what the vulnerability report looks like if you're interested. Uber is a very active program. They publish nearly all of their reports when they're done. I have it on 3 pages here. So the vulnerability was reported by a hacker named Mongo. I do not know who he is. I just know he's very, very good. Never met the guy. I don't know where he lives. I don't even know if it's a he, but it's a very good hacker. He has 749 points, which was a high point when last summer. Signal is 5, which is extremely high, and impact 24.13. So he had very high numbers coming into this. He filed a report with Uber on June 8th, and here is his first text. So you could read there what he wrote to Uber. Uber responded the same day saying, thanks for the report, Mongo. I've confirmed and triaged. We'll get to work on a remediation for this regression. Very good action from the company, responding within 1 day and triaging it and validating the report. That's how you treat hackers. So Mongo says, thank you and congratulations on the amazing response time. And then they go a little bit back and forth discussing the vulnerability. And finally, Uber says, okay, you'll get a $10,000 bounty for this. This was a fantastic report, very valid to us. And then Mongo says, thanks a lot for the great bounty. Are you okay with disclosure? Meaning, are you ready to publish the whole report? And Uber responds, yes, just give us some few days to have the meeting. They do the meeting, they publish the whole report to the world. This is how the best bug bounty programs function. Another time, there was a hacker who got really upset with Uber and started swearing so much. It was like 5 lines of just really bad words. And then at some point in his anger, he said, I want this publicly disclosed. And Uber said, okay. So if you go to HackerOne, there's a report that's completely useless by a hacker who didn't file a useful report. It's full of swear words and bad language, but it's there as an example of how not to act. But I admire Uber for publishing it, and sort of I admire the hacker from in his anger being so angry that he said, please publish this. So it shows this ever-present thing that hackers are always impatient. That's always their problem. They always want answers quickly, and they, for hackers, if they can learn to be patient, they will be fantastically successful. So on a platform like HackerOne, we run public bug bounty programs who are for everybody. We run private bug bounty programs where specific hackers are invited based on their credentials. So they invite only 50 hackers or even just 5. And then we run what we call vulnerability coordination programs where no bounties are being paid, but the company is accepting vulnerability submissions. And you may say, why would anybody file a report if they can't make a bounty? Well, the thing is, it grows your own score. So you'll do it to increase your score. It improves your own profile page. And then you can get invited to other programs. And many times you just like them, like Adobe or General Motors. They're such good brands that if you are known as one who found a vulnerability there, it's good for you. So they actually work pretty well. But most of them pay bounties. If we look at the industry as a whole, what's really missing here, and I know it because I used to be there building the internet without security, we need a software development lifecycle that takes security into consideration from the design phase. And we need to have a system where when you file a vulnerability report, we track it back to the software and back to the developer and help the developer improve their practices, their coding standards, their architecture, whatever it is, what libraries they are using, so that we get a cycle where it's fed back into the early stages of the software development lifecycle. That's what ultimately will happen. But right now, security is just a bolt-on that you add on top of the software when it's already developed. And that's why we have so many vulnerabilities. And then, and this is a message not to you hackers, but to the world, that it's completely stupid not to make use of the white hat community. We already have 100,000 hackers. It won't take long, and we will have 1 million hackers available who all are there to help the companies if the companies can say, yes, tell me what's wrong. But it's emotionally a hard thing to admit that you have weaknesses and to ask others to give you honest feedback. You know it yourselves in your lives. You don't always want to hear your friends being fully honest with you. It's painful. It's useful, but painful. But it's now happening here with software, and that will build a connected world that actually is secure, where IoT devices are secure, where they are being updated in a secure way, where they cannot be just hijacked like they are today. So then my final slide, just a little bit of self-bragging about HackerOne. We think we are a most amazing platform. We are the leading platform in this space. We've paid more bounties, we have more hackers, we have more programs than anybody else. We have the best signal-to-noise ratio, meaning we get the best vulnerability reports to our customers, and so on. But I'll leave this here, and I'm ready to take questions from the audience. There's a microphone that should be circulating here in just a moment. And there it is. That's the microphone. So ask me questions about anything. Could we have questions about bug bounties, vulnerabilities, or anything else? There are no limits. How many of you are registered hackers on HackerOne, by the way? Oh, great. 5? Excellent. That's good. That's a good start. Okay. We have our highest proportion of hackers from Holland, Belgium, Sweden, and Finland in proportion to total population. But most of our hackers are from India, Russia, and the US. Okay, do we have a question?
Yeah. So it's a great initiative, HackerOne, and all the communication between the hackers and the industry. But one vector or one thing that seems missing is the education. You said that basically most of the people are self-taught, and kind of you have the data and you have all the disclosed reports, and you could kind of use that to improve education, kind of to new people learn how to easier hack, how to use the tools, and kind of you could, because in my opinion, the human hacker won't scale. With all the software becoming more, we need better tooling, we need to improve the methods, we need education and all these things. So basically, can you use the data you have from all the disclosed stuff to see what are the good tools the people use, what are the methods, and to give this back to tool developers, to education platforms, all these things kind of that improve the people who do the work, kind of all these things. So have you ever thought about that?
Yes, we think about that every day. That's a great question. We actually have a slightly diverging view on it. Yes, we do help educate hackers. And like we helped publish a book called Web Hacking 101, where the author was writing it and we helped him make it much, much better. We're giving it for free to all new hackers who sign up. So we are doing that. And of course, you can read our published reports and learn more. Then I also know that to be a hacker, you must have curiosity. And if we must bring the education to you, you don't have curiosity. So in a way, we mustn't make it too easy because we need the people who have that endless curiosity who will go and find it. So we make the information available, but I'm not sure we should try to push it to people because then some people who don't have that tenacity and curiosity will think they can be hackers when they can't. It really requires that very specific drive. So that's one thing. As for tooling, yes, many are working on automated tooling to detect vulnerabilities automatically. There are startups in that space, there are other companies in that space. I think the world will slowly go that direction. I do not think it is easy, and I don't think it will ever cover the whole space. I have this belief and conviction that human beings will always outperform automated scanning solutions because the flaws are created by humans. And because only humans enough are crazy enough to create them, only humans are crazy enough to find them. I could be wrong on this. It's my conviction. I'm not saying it's a scientific truth. But we believe that in this man versus machine, sure, we will need machine as well, but we will never run out of need for man. The vulnerabilities will rise onto a higher level. And even today, we see that vulnerabilities on the lowest level of the software stack are not that interesting anymore because many run on cloud services that take care of the lower end of the stack. But there's plenty of vulnerabilities in the application logic, and I think humans will be needed to find them. That's why 14-year-old kids find them, but scanners do not find them. There's a lot of false positives in automated scanners. That's my view. Next question.
You mentioned that it's very discouraging for a reporter to learn that his or her report is a duplicate. And that happens very often, as just a small percentage of bugs is publicly announced. Do you have any way to demonstrate any objective evidence for a reporter that he is not the first one?
Yes, it's a sensitive question. Sometimes when the company responds and say, thank you for your report, but it's a duplicate, the hacker will say, how do I know? How do I know that you are not just gaming me now or playing with me? We believe that most programs are fully honest and they want the engagement from the hacker, so they wouldn't resort to such cheap tricks. But we are also thinking of ways we could shorten the cycle between something found and being published. And now, when a vulnerability is found, we can't tell the whole world because it hasn't been fixed. But at some point, we should tell hackers and say, by the way, there is already a report in roughly in this area, and so you shouldn't perhaps hack there because if you find something, it may be a duplicate. But it's a very sensitive area because we must take care of the secrecy of the bug until it has been fixed. Of course, we would like to alert all hackers and say, hey, something has been found here. You should know that you are at higher risk of running into a duplicate. And I think over time we will figure out better technology to steer people away from the duplicates. But I don't think it's possible to become a successful hacker without going through a lot of humiliating duplicates. I think it is like Formula One drivers. If you end up second in the race, you were an amazing driver, but you didn't win. sort of it can be disappointing to know that you did your best and you did a good job, yet it wasn't good enough to give you the bounty. So we're thinking of ways to do that. I don't have a solution right now, but we are aware that it's emotionally draining when you file 12 great vulnerability reports and then 8 come back as duplicates. Then you say, okay, I wasted all this time. So it's a painful moment. We know that. Here's a question.
About the publication of the reports, you mentioned that not all companies publish all the reports. So from the point of view of the reputation, how a hacker who has published a valid report can get a reputation from a company that does not publish their report?
Yeah, good question.
And also, yeah. Are there companies which agree or that they publish all the valid reports?
There's one company that publishes all reports, that's HackerOne. On our own bug bounty program, we do that. Uber is doing it 100% or nearly 100%. But for a hacker, it doesn't matter. You will get the same reputation score, signal, and impact, irrespective of whether the report is published or not. And the points you get are determined by the severity of the bug. So you certainly grow your own score whether or not it's published. We hope that ultimately everything will be published because it will be for the good of the world to publicly disclose the reports. But then we know that this is a new practice for many companies, and just paying a bug bounty is very scary for many. And when I'm out there selling to traditional companies all day long, and they always say, but Martin, how do I know the hackers are really good? What if they suddenly turn black hat when they just wear white hat? And am I not just inviting criminals by doing this? And they have all these worries. And it will take some time for the world to see the value of this, just as it took time for open source software to do the same. I joined open source software in 2001, when companies would say that open source is banned and you are not allowed to use open source and it's dangerous. And now, if you don't use open source, you're stupid. So the shift is complete. I think the same will happen with security, and it will take a few years. But anyhow, hackers do get their points in all cases. So that's how the algorithm works. Very good. I think we're out of time. Thank you, everybody. Welcome to sign up as hackers.